And we're back. It has been an absolutely awesome day, and it's only about to get better. I'm Mia Zachary, and you are listening to Elemental Abundance, the source of soul evolution. Our show is the result of my utter fascination with conventional science and with metaphysics, and my absolute belief that the concept of abundance can be broken down into elementary practices that you can incorporate into your life every day. Really, I was looking for a way to say yes to my life. There's so many times and ways that we feel stuck, that we feel like we're not moving forward, that we're not making progress, and I wanted to be able to say yes to everything that was being offered to me instead of, you know, no, maybe later or waiting or whatever. So that is the purpose and intention of Elemental Abundance. So if you are joining us on Facebook Live or on YouTube Live, hey, do me a favor and share this out. There might be someone else who wants to share this information, meet my guest, Michelle Gordon, who I'll introduce you to in a moment, or just hear some of the concepts that we're going to be sharing. So this episode is sponsored by Tredic Images Studio in Bowie, Maryland, and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about these pictures a little bit later, but in the meantime, I would love to introduce my very special guest today, Michelle Gordon of Murray Yoga in Rockville, Maryland. Michelle, thank you so much for joining me today.
Hi, Mia.
Welcome. So our theme today is awareness, and we'll talk about that in a couple minutes, but first I wanted to give people an opportunity to get to know you. So what would you love for people to know about Michelle Gordon?
I think I'd like people to know that I'm a certified Swarupa yoga teacher, first and foremost, and that is to bring this beautiful, gentle, loving style of yoga to help people find more than just yoga poses, which is peace of mind and being able to go inward to find the inner self, which is sometimes challenging to go in there deep and find. And that I'm patient and I'm a giver, and this is reflects in my teaching of my classes.
Fantastic. So Svarupa, it's S-V-A-R-O-O-P-A?
Yeah, some people say sva and some people say swa. You'll hear the yes W a little bit easier to say, and they're both acceptable. So it was
a this is a style of yoga, or?
It's a style of hatha yoga. It was begun by who was then referred to as Rama Birch. She since has been received her swami monkship in yoga, and she's a yoga swami now, Nirmalananda Saraswati. And so we call her Nirmala. We've come up with a couple different quick names, but she spent about 9 years in ashrams in India, Ganeshpuri to be exact, which is where the lineage is from, and her style of yoga. And when she was ready to come home from India, she landed in San Diego, on the streets of San Diego, and decided, I think I'm here to teach some yoga. And that's how she got started. It was over 25 years ago.
Wow. Wow. And what attracted you to this particular style? Why is this what you teach?
It's kind of funny, my start, because my sister, who lives in Florida, comes up about once a year, and she was up one summer and said, I think yoga is really for you, Michelle. And I sort of didn't really know what yoga was. I don't even think I had seen a video of poses of yoga. So my commute was long. I lived on the Delaware Eastern Shore, and I lived in Ocean View, Delaware, and worked in Milford, which is north toward Dover. And on my way home, I go through Lewis, which is 5 points. It's where five roads come together. And I always saw a blue OM sign on the side of a yellow building. And each month, I would be coming, doing my regular commute home, and saying, on the right side of the road at 5 points, I wonder what yoga is. So I waited until a summer when I wasn't working, had off, and I tried yoga, and that was Svarupa. It was all she wrote. I never looked back.
Fantastic, fantastic. So how do you believe that you make a difference through Murray Yoga Studio?
I think people are invited in to really see if they're a fit for my style. I always used to joke that yoga studios are a little like liquor stores. They're on every street corner. But I think what athletic styles see and do is their clients or students are the ones that want an athletic, active style of yoga. And I don't make any bones about it in marketing. I let them know, sure, come and try us. But it's very different. It comes from a very different paradigm, this style. So we use blankets instead of mats for our props. And we prop each student in every angle in the pose so that they're comfortable in an angle. They're never required to hold an angle, and we never take anyone to the point of pain. Difference between spinal tension or tension in a joint or muscle as opposed to pain. And we're there to support them, and I think that's what my students see once they decide they want to come, and then they stay. So it's a longer-lasting yoga. It doesn't hurt you. It's gentle. It's accessible for just about every body type. And we take care of you when you come in to try this style. It's very sweet.
That is so beautiful and really so indicative of what I know about you. You always are just this beautiful, gentle support around everyone around you. And that's really why I wanted to invite you, you know, to be my guest today, because I love how you show up in the world. You have this sort of radiant, fun aspect to you, but in like a really soft, quiet, and inviting way. And it's one of the things I like best about you, Michelle.
That's very neat.
So I wanted to have a conversation with you around awareness today, because I think correct me if I'm wrong, but in yoga, you kind of have to be aware of where your body is and where your breathing is and where your breath is at any time, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I found this quote, and it's ascribed to Abraham H. Maslow. And he says, "What is necessary to change a person is to change his awareness of himself." So where are you in your personal awareness? You know, this whole enlightenment, personal development, ascension, descension, whatever, it's a journey. Where are you with your own personal changes?
It is absolutely a journey. I think when you start off in any modality, even if you're just using exploration as a way to get into Reiki, massage, acupuncture, there is so much out there. And my path really took me to yoga because of stress. I wasn't looking to do anything particularly physical with my body. I just knew what I was trying to balance: the work, the home, go, 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 work multiple jobs, not stopping. It's the way of the busy life. It's not just about living in or near a city or a major metropolis either. So awareness is really about pausing long enough to go inside. I think when you learn to stop in your day, even if it's for 30 seconds, you mentioned breathing, even in the midst of your day or stress, it could be a great, beautifully smooth day. It could be the day when a work colleague is all elevated and wants to bring you down their path, so to speak, in a not so good way. So it's quieting yourself long enough to go inside. And some people can find that with a healing modality. Some do that by sitting in nature. So it is a long path. I've been teaching almost 15 years this year.
Wow.
And each year gets a lot better. It seems to be progressing now over the last couple years a little faster, because I have gone inward very deeply to examine how I am reacting to these different situations, even traffic in the major metropolis.
It's not always, I mean, I find it very hard sometimes to pause. I'm kind of like an Energizer bunny, especially when I'm excited or passionate about what I'm doing, or if I'm on a deadline, which usually is both of those situations in my life. So for those of us who, you know, have trouble pausing and taking a look inside and the things that you were talking about, What are some of the elementary practices that we can bring, you know, to our day-to-day life?
I think to first recognize where those excitements or busyness areas are is really important. It is hard to slow down, so mainly it's just taking a look in and seeing if you can pause during that time. Really, awareness is all about slowing yourself down long enough to be able to recognize the state that you're in at the moment you're in that state, and then to be able to use your tools that you've learned, whether it's breath or glancing out a work window to see a beautiful tree in bloom, an instant thought of someone that you love that you don't get to see that often or hear their voice, and begin to be aware, stay with that moment a little longer so that you can be aware of what you were aware of during that time. It's almost repetitive. And I could talk about yoga practices like laying down and relaxation or the breath.
I call that a nap.
There is a nap. Breath is very important, but you can start to learn these tools. And that's one thing that we teach. We teach a relaxation shavasana at the beginning and end of every class.
Shavasana.
Shavasana, right.
Shavasana.
And it actually means corpse pose because that's what it translates to. But of course, we call it relaxation because you're not thinking of death. You're thinking of a body that's still and not moving, and that's one way to achieve it in this pose. So there's a guided awareness. You're talking yourself through your body, which is important because if a teacher's not leading you through guided awareness, toes all the way up to your head and vice versa, you can teach that to yourself, like when you've been wakened at night or resting, and then you start to remember the guided awareness that was told to you, and you're talking yourself through your body that way. And while they're in relaxation, we always teach the breath. Most yoga classes, the traditional hatha styles, end their class in a relaxation, and breath is usually a big part of their practices. We begin and end in a relaxation so that the poses in between, you've got that opening, you've got the beautiful muscle style of release, but you're able to bring it inside again before you get up and come into your day. So it was a great question. It's hard to isolate what each person is attracted to, mm-hmm. but it's nice when you can start to be aware of some of the things around you. Even me looking at these beautiful portraits of you in front of me, I can sort of isolate that. I know that's Mia. It reminds me of being with Mia, and I can relax while I'm doing that, even if I'm seeing the picture at my workspace. It's a
Thank
beautiful
you.
Thing. You would do that probably with your son,
right.
Healing stones, something that you have present there to help you be aware or to pause you in the busy day.
Thank you. These portraits were done by Tredic Images Studios, who's our sponsor today, and I'll talk about them a little bit more. And it's funny that you mention the stones, because I do have quartz crystal, moonstone, citrine, sodalite, and rose quartz in front of us today, just to bring some beautiful energy to the room. That's one of my tools for awareness. Is I have rocks in my pockets every day when I leave the house. Depending on what I need that day, I use those. But I'd like to go back, if we could, to the awareness of breath. Because it has taken me a long time to realize I don't always breathe well. And it's not until you, because I'm always on the go and I'm usually, sometimes I have to, like somebody else usually has to stop me and go, okay, take a deep breath in, let it out. And it's not until I do that I realize like how tight my abdomen is and how closed my chest is. Is there anything that you might be able to share with us that you could guide somebody through, even though this is a radio show?
Breathing is very important. There are probably thousands of styles of breath out there that are taught in different modalities, like yoga. And we teach a slower, sustained breath, but the most important thing you can learn with your own personal practice is to simply listen to your sound. So if
what does that mean, to listen to my sound?
You'll be making a sound. Our breath is listen to the sound your own breath makes as it moves in and out. And then before the practice begins, you're slowing the breath down to listen to the sound inside that you're creating. It's a technique that we teach that narrows the throat passageway. The breath comes in through the nose, through your narrowed throat, and back out through your nose. So some people relate that to deep or diaphragmatic breathing, but we don't call it that. So the sound is the most important part of the practice, and breath sound in this way always trumps yoga poses. So if people go home, the ones that wish they would do a longer practice or a daily practice and they skipped a day or skipped some of their poses, my motto is don't beat yourself up, do the breath, because the breath is always recommended every day and it will improve all the body systems. It's proven, medical science is now looking at that and seeing the benefits. So when you're talking about improving body systems with your breath, we're talking neurological, circulatory, respiratory, and when your body systems improve, it softens the organs and the flow of blood through your body in this way. And you become softer. You also become, in your personality, softer, kinder, even the ability to give love and receive love. All of that begins to change. And we teach it as a daily practice so that people will try to go home, and it's got the health benefits if you do it every day, 20 minutes once per day in the way that we instruct. It can lower high blood pressure. And for chronic conditions like asthma or severely high blood pressure, we recommend two sets of 20 minutes, like bookends on your day.
Nice, nice. I want to go back to something you said a moment ago, because I feel like that is a really important thing to be aware of. You said if you didn't do what you intended to do, don't beat yourself up about it. And I really love that. It leads really nicely into the next quote that I had, which is from Amit Ray and his book, Meditations, Insights and Inspirations. The quote is, "Your greatest awakening comes when you are aware about your infinite nature." And so I like what you said about, you know, don't beat yourself up. It's like, okay, you didn't jog today, or you didn't do yoga, or you didn't drink, 32 ounces of water or whatever. Be aware that you can always start again, and you don't have to wait until tomorrow. It's like, okay, I'll do it tomorrow. It's like, okay, so you didn't get up at 5 o'clock this morning and do your yoga poses and your breathing. Well, it's 7 p.m. now. Be aware that you didn't do it, but don't beat yourself up about it, but make your elemental practice, you know, at 7 p.m. instead of 5 p.m. As long as it's something that makes you feel good, you can do it at any time, right?
Exactly. I tell students to, if you want to begin with a daily practice, or you would like to start to feel like you're committed to feeling a lot better and accessing your inner self, I tell them to set you're a morning person, you're waking up for work, set your alarm about 10 or 20 minutes before you typically set it. It's a sleepy time. Maybe you've gotten up, almost gotten yourself ready or started the coffee, but you're not ready to go start your day. This is a great time to use an egg timer or the phone timer and just start your breath. And yes, it's earlier, and yes, it takes a little commitment, but that helps a lot. And also, 20 minutes is not suited to most people. Some students, I say, if you're amazed at the 20 minutes, start with 5, add 1 minute per day, and then report back after a week what was the number of minutes that felt good. Some people, 20 minutes goes by really fast. Other people practiced for a week and said 12 was about it for me, and I said, well, then 12 is it for you. So you can do that with little things that you enjoy, like the one we talked about, doing something at work or pausing for a moment to focus on something. All of these are tools that you can use that you have inside. You just have to remember that you have them inside.
I like that. And I love the fact that you really, there seems to be no judgment from you. that your 20-minute person is perfect in that practice, and your 12-minute person is perfect in that. I've got too many P's and R's in the sentence, but you know what I'm trying to say. Because I think that's another thing that we need to be more aware of, is that the only person we need to compete with is who we were a minute ago, yesterday, last year. And if 12 minutes is what feels good for me, then that's okay. The fact that the person next to me is doing 30 minutes, that's okay. And I don't need to, you know, I need to be aware that I don't need to compete.
Yeah, there's no competition in our classes. I think if people start, when they first start, and they if you haven't done yoga, you like to watch the person next to you because you're mimicking the moves that they're doing. Of course, you want to get into angles and try the pose, but that's one thing that is very different in our style as opposed to some other styles that are really getting it in their angles.
Very cool. Very cool. What else would you like to share about awareness? What else? What does that word actually mean to you, awareness?
I think the greatest thing that being aware of events or every single part of my day, even when I don't know that I'm aware of it, almost sounds contradicting. But you can learn this practice by pausing and going inward just to quiet yourself for a couple of minutes, and then you increase that over time or increase the days. I looked out the window Monday, here it is Wednesday, and I'm glancing out the window again at that beautiful blossom. And so I want to say it sort of creeps up on you, but it does take practice. It takes an intention. And when you make the intention to try to quiet yourself, we've been busy. Think about happiness, how we're conditioned through life, almost all of our childhood and life, to look outside of ourselves for what makes us happy. So this can be material things. It can be entertainment, all the things that we look for that keep us happy and not thinking about the things that we don't want to be burdened with.
Then
by the time you reach adulthood, think how busy you've become and think how many more things you've collected and gathered. And it's almost out of control. Now we have that problem where we have too much stuff. We have so much stuff we don't know what to do with the stuff. And yet we're still busy as bees and not able to rest ourselves or calm ourselves down long enough to pause. So those pauses and awareness really gain awareness to what we call the self with a capital S inside you.
Absolutely.
And
that's a hard
nut to swallow because
it is.
We don't know what that capital S self is, because how many times have we been able to be quiet and also access it? So I just try to remember that I do remember when I went inward in that way, or I paused long enough to not be busy and to see what a beautiful thing that is that's inside you. It's your birthright. It is inside you and always has been inside you. And for you to be able to locate it, access it, there's probably a better word to find it, you'll want to return there again. So it isn't about giving up movies, giving up milkshakes, you know, stop going out on dates or what have you. It's about looking inside and being able to see that there is so much in you that is so beautiful.
I think that is what I can probably give the most credit to about my own spiritual journey, was that constantly looking out, wanting my ex-husband to make me happy, wanting my job to make me happy, wanting, you know, entertainment and friends and, you know, wine and whatever else I was into to make me happy. I think that was probably the greatest gift of awareness that I was given, was the recognition that I am responsible for my happiness, and that looking inward and not comparing myself anymore. She's prettier than me. She's thinner than me. You know, she's smarter than me. You know, all of those things that we do. I'm not going to go off on a rant about, you know, social media and advertising and all the other things that make us feel like shit in America in this day and age. But for the most part, I think, you know, that really... I'm still not that great with the pausing and the breathing, but I'm getting better with the looking inward and that capital S self-awareness. And, you know,
it's funny that you mentioned social media because I was avoiding it like the plague, even though I was toying with it, but not really knowing how to use it for the growth of my business. And now if I tweet something or post it or go to the business page and want to talk about a topic that's hot right then or that interests me, I will reread it the next day to see if it's something I really wanted out there. And I have gone back and looked at material that, not just articles and research articles, those are interesting to me and I think they're great reads for the public, but I've gone back and deleted something that I didn't really feel belonged there.
Yeah, and that's
also awareness because it teaches me to go back and not... I'm not thinking so much while I'm typing that particular post, but I sure can read it later when if I don't wait too long and it doesn't disappear.
Absolutely. That's why all of my social media settings are set to public, so that's just a little reminder to me to be aware of what I'm saying and the fact that, you know, the internet is apparently forever. And so that's my awareness is it's like, is this really something that I want to put out there? Is this really what I want to say? You know, I'm not just posting it to a couple of friends. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm aware that I'm saying it to everyone. Is this how I want to show up in the world? You know, is this how I want people to become aware of me is through what I'm saying?
It is absolutely exposing and you have to be aware of it, especially when you want... you want to get it out there. I post a lot of things public. I feel real good about that because I want the whole world to know what it is I'm doing.
Well, I absolutely love what you're doing, and I thank you so much for coming on to share who you are and what you do and how you have an impact on the world.
Thank you for having me.
So before we go, I want to just talk about our sponsor for a moment. Our sponsor once again is Tredic Images Studio, located in Bowie, Maryland, and they are responsible for these images. I needed a new headshot for my website, so I had that taken with my Elemental Abundance cards and some of the crystals that I use. There's a completely different mood and style. I wanted something that was kind of fun and playful for my personal profile. And then there's this image, which is a little softer, a little more professional. But I really appreciated the work that Tredic Image Studios did for me and that they can also do for you. And as you can see on the screen, they're located in Bowie, Maryland. You can contact Jim at Tredic Images. That's T-R-E-T-I-C-K images.com. And there's the phone number, 301-704-6111. Michelle, I really appreciate everything that you've brought to share with our audience today. And I'm wondering, is there something that's precious to you? Is there something that, you know, has stayed with you? Is something that you would want to share as sort of your, not your final words, I don't want to say it that way, but like just a parting thought, let's call it that.
I think one of the best things people can do is just slow down. It's probably the hardest thing to picture a busy working self to do. And you can look for ways to do that. Think about your favorite image or your favorite place in the whole world. And if you can't be there, maybe it's Costa Rica, maybe it's India, you can still focus on that beautiful time that you had. I'm a believer in putting the pictures around you that you love so that they can surround you during your workspace or your day. And those really help. It helps bring you to where you can return to. And also to bring those images inside you because you carry those memories and those beautiful things that you were able to do, whether it be a vacation or a retreat with you. They stay with you all your life, which is why they are your favorites. So I hope that helps people that are out there still working really hard and busy and wishing that they can find that beautiful happiness inside.
Well, and I hope that they can begin to find some of that beautiful happiness with you. Once again, my guest today was Michelle Gordon. You can find her at Murray, that's M little I capital R, little E with the thingy over it, yoga. And she is located at 11910 Park Lawn Drive in Rockville, Maryland. You can reach Michelle. You can, you know, email her to contact, to comment on the show or ask her any questions about the Swarupa yoga. You can find her at bliss3630 at hotmail.com. So that's B-L-I-S-S 3630 at hotmail.com. Or if you're local to Maryland, give Murray Yoga a call at 301-946-1517. So before we wrap up, I want to leave you with one more quote. This one is from Meister Eckhart. And he says, "The eye through which I see God is the same eye through which God sees me. My eye and God's eye are one eye, one seeing, one knowing, one love." So, with that in mind, be aware of the love that is all around you. Be aware that there is something greater looking at you, looking out for you, and looking at the path ahead for you. Be aware that you have a choice of what you see. These two things in the front of your face, those are just the lens. How you interpret that in your mind and in your heart and in your spirit is what you really see. So be aware of how you're showing up in the world. Be aware of who you're being. Be aware of your beliefs and how they make a difference for yourself and other people in the world. And if you'd like to start a conversation, please feel free to visit the website, which is www.mentaldancing.com. You can get in touch with me there. You can listen to episodes of the podcast. You can order the Elemental Abundance card deck. And you can also find a directory guide. So if you're looking for someone to, teach you yoga, you'll find Michelle Gordon on the Mental Dancing website as one of our guests. And you can also find me on social media. If you type the @ and then mental dancing into a Google search, you'll find me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Pinterest. So without further ado, thank you so much for joining me for this episode of Elemental Abundance. Until next time, I wish you love, I wish you great success, and more than anything else, I wish you joy.